All right, we're going to finish out with primary versus secondary immune deficiency diseases. And I mean, this lecture is pretty brief. Usually, it's I think you know, students find it relatively interesting because it touches on a lot of things that we've heard about, or maybe you've read in the news, or in some cases, maybe you have friends or family that wrestle with some of these things. But they're a little bit more, I guess, unusual is a reasonable way to classify them. And some of them are very, very aggressive, okay? And so maybe it's a good thing that they're slightly unusual, but they tend to be very aggressive. And so when we talk about immune deficiency diseases, this is very different than an autoimmunity. Like where we just came from with hypersensitivity, and you have an autoimmunity to a tissue, the immune system is operating the way it's supposed to. It's doing what it's supposed to do. The problem is, it's targeting you and killing a part of you. And you're like, well, that shouldn't do that. Yeah, it shouldn't do that, but the part that broke down was the self-tolerance mechanism. It wasn't the process. Does that make sense? So like the car is driving just the way it's supposed to drive, the driver is going too fast. It's not really the car is not working correctly, it's the driver has got their foot down on the pedal too hard and is doing like 100 miles an hour through a red light. You with me? So in where we just came from, there's nothing wrong with the functionality of the immune system. What was wrong is one little aspect of self-tolerance mechanism went awry. And you created a B or a T cell that found a piece of you and said they're going to attack it. Now here, with an immune deficiency disease, there is truly something fundamentally wrong with the system. Okay? And so they can either be primary, congenital, meaning you're born with it, or they're secondary and they're acquired. And either of them are kind of sobering ideas, to be totally honest. But we're going to go through both of them. So if we look at primary deficiencies, again, these are ones that you're born with. And this is a busy slide and we'll break it down, don't worry, we usually do. If you look at the top of this, we've got a pluripotent stem cell. So this is a stem cell that has the ability to become all sorts of different things, right? And we're at the level of the bone marrow. So we're in this box, we're in the bone marrow, and so we're getting ready to manufacture B cells. And then we manufacture B cells, and we've got all the different types of immunoglobulins that these B cells can make at the bottom. We've got our IgM, our IgG, our IgA, and our IgE. Make sense? And then if we leave the bone marrow, and essentially we go out into the thymus, although it doesn't say that here, but that's where T cell maturation occurs. You remember that from last time. You can see that this stem cell can become T cells, and we can either get a CD4 or CD8 mature T cell. And that's our adaptive immune system in a nutshell. And there's a lot of other details that I'm going to explain here in a second, but I want you to understand the map, what the map is showing. It's showing B cell and T cell maturation on one slide, and this should be familiar to us because we went over this. And they're all coming from a pluripotent stem cell that originates in the bone marrow. So now you can start seeing if we've got problems that occur at different spots, right? So for example, let's go down to this little red squiggly lines. And that's what we're zooming in right here. This is an X-linked a gamma globulinemia, otherwise known as Bruton's disease or Bruton's disorder. And it's sex-linked. It's a rare X-linked genetic disorder that was discovered in the early 1950s. And these patients do not develop a significant population of B cells. So they have low or absent B cells and plasma cells, but they have a completely normal T cell response. Because the T cells again, come off over here. And we're talking about down here. So T cells are fine, but they don't make really any functional amount of immunoglobulins. That's our B cell example. Okay? One more B cell example that I want to highlight, and then we'll get into a T cell example, and then we're going to get into a combo example, and that's it. That's what we have to know. Okay? So one more B cell example. This one's actually the most common primary deficiency. This is a selective IgA deficiency, which is this squiggly line way down here. And so obviously, if it's selective IgA, they don't make IgA. But do they make IgE, G, and M? Yes. Do they make T cells? Yes. Okay. This is the most common primary deficiency, more so than Bruton's disorder. So Bruton's is pretty aggressive. So I gave you a very aggressive example, and now I'm giving you an example that's the most common. And in these patients, they're very susceptible to recurrent infections, especially where IgA is most commonly used. And it's usually found in the blood and in body secretions. And so they develop infections on the skin, and they develop systemic infections more so than you and I, because they don't make IgA. But they have everything else. All right, we're going to back up. We're going to go over to the T cell side for our single T cell example. So we back up the chain. We're over to the T cell. This is the DeGeorge syndrome. So in the DeGeorge syndrome, they develop a partial or no thymus. So the thymus sits kind of in the neck region above the heart. And obviously, it's very important for T-cell maturation. That's what we learned about in the last unit. And if you have a DeGeorge syndrome disorder, then your thymus didn't develop correctly. And in these patients, they have low or no mature T-cells. They're very susceptible to viral, fungal, and protozoan infections. In some patients, it's been pediatric medicine has looked at doing thymal transplants, which have been successful in some of these younger patients. There are milder versions, I guess, of this that are existing in the literature, meaning that the thymus forms, you know, maybe 40% or 50%, and so they have some population of mature T cells, but they don't have what you and I enjoy. And so they're just more susceptible to these infections, but they don't necessarily have zero T cell maturation. And then the last one of the primaries that I want to look at or want to focus on is what we call a combo or a combined. So this is what's known as the ADA deficiency, also referred to as a skin disorder or a severe combined immunodeficiency. And if you look further up on the tree, on the ADA, we get stem cells, we get this lymphoid precursor, but we never make a pro-T cell, we never make a pro-B cell. So these patients don't develop B cells, nor do they develop T cells. Okay? And some of you, many of you are too young to remember this, but in the 1980s, okay? And I wasn't born yet, I just read about this. It might have even been the 70s. But there is an individual named David Vedder. And you can Google David Vedder. He had a name, his name was Bubble Boy. And he was one of the first ADA deficiency cases that was well researched and publicized. And he was in the news a lot. I can't remember. It must have been early 80s if it was the 80s. It could have been the late 70s. But he lived his life in a bubble because he didn't have a functional immune system. Had to be a sterile environment. Now, we create mouse knockouts that are skin mouse knockouts for research purposes. Okay? And they model it after this ADA deficiency. And it's a power powerful tool from a research standpoint because you can look at a lot of transplant type of studies without worrying about, say, human cells being transplanted into a mouse being rejected. And so SCID mice, S-C-I-D, same nomenclature, is an organism that exists in the laboratory environment, and they have to be housed in bubbles. They have to be housed in very specialized housing in order to, you know, keep them alive. But otherwise, they do just fine as long as they don't come in contact with anything that's dangerous in the outside environment. I mean, viral, bacterial, or fungal. Okay, so last up is secondary immune disorders. And these guys are acquired. You're not born with them. Secondary. Acquired. And there's a list. And you can see here your question from earlier on stress. Stress is on the list. So glucocorticoids suppress broadly the immune system. So they are listed as a secondary immune disorder. Stress. Right? So the next time you get a bad grade on your English exam, you can say that you had a secondary immunodeficiency disorder to your English professor. But if you try to tell your pathology professor that, I'll know you're just blowing my leg, right? But in reality, you're not. Cancer, malnutrition, bone marrow suppression is an example of an iatrogenic cause. Iatrogenic is a term that means an adverse side effect resulting from something else. Or infection. All of these can cause stress or lower the immune system, like malnutrition. If you lower your zinc uptake, it depletes B and T cell production. Zinc helps to foster B and T cell production. That's why you see a lot of these cold remedies have zinc in them, and to some level, there's some science behind that. All right, so the one that I'm going to highlight in the remaining time that we have is an acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, AIDS. The etiology is from human immunodeficiency virus. Again, I'm not an expert in HIV. I only use it as an example to drive home a point on the secondary immune deficiency disorder. Okay? As most of us are very familiar or at least casually familiar with the news, and we might even be familiar because we know people that wrestle with this. But it likely arose, the literature describes it likely arose from a simian immunodeficiency virus and began diversification in the 1930s. It was found, the earliest reports in the late 50s, 1959, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, is where it was first discovered in humans. Today, the most common transfer venue is heterosexual activity. It can be transferred in the blood, intravenous drug use, sexual intercourse, or maternal fetal transfer. So someone would argue, well, then maybe the baby is born with it, so it's primary. Well, what we mean by that is born with is it's in the genome, it's coded for, not that you acquired it in utero. Okay? The etiology of HIV, it's a retrovirus, right? It's got a virus core. And there's a lipid envelope that is from the host, and you'll see how this host lipid envelope shows up. And it has a very aggressive mutation rate, which is one of the reasons it's been so difficult to eradicate or even to get under control. Although nowadays, the therapies are much more favorable than they were, say, even 10 years ago. But it's this mutation rate that makes it very, very difficult in order to treat. And so what I want to hone in on is the pathogenesis of HIV and how it shows up in the body. Okay, and that's the last couple of slides that I have for you. So T helper cells. T helper cells are the cells that unfortunately are targeted. So here you can see this is a cell membrane of a T helper cell. It's expressing CD4, right? That's how you know it's a T helper, right? Macrophages and dendritic cells also have CD4 and can also be affected. or infected, I should say, by the HIV virus. But essentially what happens is we've got this virus here, and we can see that at some point it needs to bind to the CD4 complex. And when it does so, it utilizes what's called the CCR5 receptor that's required for this docking to take place. Once that happens, there's this conformational change. See how it pivots? And as it starts to pivot, it's moving its membrane closer and closer, which then fuses, and then it injects its virus core into the recipient or into the host. And again, helper T cells are primary. Dendritic cells, as well as macrophages, can also be infected with the virus itself. What's interesting about the CCR5 receptor is there is a population of patients that have been identified as being absent, CCR5 absent, and so they're immune to the HIV virus, which has been discovered in the last few years as being a very, very positive area of research that we might be able to exploit. So the infection, how does it progress? Well, it progresses as an acute infection, and then it builds in a chronic phase. You've got peripheral lymphoid tissues that are affected. The spleen is also one of those tissues that's infected. And then there's ongoing replication and cell death because it takes over the functionality of that helper T cell. And that helper T cell, as you guys remember, has activity not only on antibody production and stimulating antibody production, but also over on cytotoxic T cells. And so the helper T cell is that linchpin of the immune system, and by targeting that cell, and that cell essentially almost exclusively, you're taking out the entire adaptive immune system. Okay, so we've got a couple of different phases before it gets to full-blown AIDS. We've got our CD4 cells, or our dendritic cells. They get into this phase of viremia, where you're building up the population of active virus within the body. And you develop these antibodies to HIV. You go into this clinical latency phase, which could last for 10 years. And in that clinically latent phase, you've got the provirus that is incorporated into your helper T cell population into the genome, and it stays there. But then at some point in time, it comes out of the clinical latency phase and it starts to replicate. And as it replicates, it starts lysing cells and your helper T cell population starts to diminish. And that's what ultimately leads to the patient expiring. And so here's a summary graph, which is the last slide for the day. I know I went a little long. We've got helper T cell population on this axis in the blue. Here's our primary infection. You can see there's an initial drop, and then the body kind of recovers a little bit, and it enters this clinical latency phase until it continues to drop off as far as the number of helper T cells. On this axis is the number of HIV RNA copies. So there's this huge bolus increase. It drops off, it slowly climbs, but not much significant increase over the latency period, and then it really ramps up, and it's ramping up the number of copies of the virus while the HIV, or while the number of helper T cells is diminishing. And what the patient usually passes from are these opportunistic diseases. They'll develop respiratory infections, right? They'll develop a cold or a flu, and unfortunately that's what takes these patients. It's not necessarily AIDS or HIV. It's some other opportunistic bacteria or virus that takes the patient. Okay? Thanks for hanging in there for a few extra minutes. Remember, Friday you have your post quiz. And because I know I might get a lot of you in my office on Wednesday, and I might be a little late because of my dentist appointment, I'm going to see about my Friday morning if I can add some extra office hours on Friday morning. Okay? I'll send out an email.